everyone, welcome back to my channel 5-Minute Economics, where I teach economic concepts in a span of just 5 minutes. The topic for today is the Mundell-Fleming model. And in today's video, I'll be talking about the introduction of the topic as well as the fixed and the flexible exchange rates under perfect and imperfect capital mobility. So yeah, let's get started. Also guys, don't forget to subscribe to my channel in case you haven't already so that you don't miss on my future videos. So coming to the introduction of the topic, the Mundell-Fleming model is basically an extension to the ISLM model and hence sometimes also referred to as the ISLM-BP model. I have made a video regarding the ISLM model. I'll attach the link in the comment section below. I would suggest you watch that video first and then this one, as it will be easier for you to grasp this topic. Secondly, it was developed by Robert Mundell and Marcus Fleming and hence the name Mundell-Fleming. So basically in ISLM, we studied dealing with autarky, that is a closed economy. And under ISLM-BP model, we'll be studying, you know, a small open economy case. And that's why also you can say that in addition to goods and money market, we will be dealing with the balance of payments. So basically guys, the Mundell-Fleming model is divided into two parts. The first one being given by Mundell, which dealt with perfect mobility of capital. And the second one, which is a more rigorous one, is given by Fleming, which dealt with imperfect capital mobility. In today's time, we consider Mundell's model more acceptable than the Fleming's model. Moving ahead, I'll give you a flashback of what IS and LM curves look like. So the IS curve represents the goods market. It is a curve which is downward sloping towards the right, as I told you earlier, just like the demand curve. And the LM curve represents the money market. It slopes upward just like the supply curve. And the new addition in this video is the BP or the BOP curve, which is representing balance of payments. Here we can see it is a horizontal line parallel to the x-axis. And once we derive the BP curve, one point should be noticed is that any point above the BP curve is known as the balance of payments surplus, and any point below the BP curve is known as the balance of payments deficit. So guys, now I'll be talking about the perfect mobility case. And here I'll first be talking about the fixed exchange regime. And under here, we have two cases. Okay, so we'll be talking about monetary and fiscal policy. In case you have a slight doubt also in these two topics, please refer to my videos. I'll attach the link in the comment section below for these two videos. So coming to the first case, we notice over here on the x-axis, we have the output and on the y-axis, we have the interest rate. Now, the first case we see an expansionary monetary policy case. In this case, our LM curve shifts from LM to LM dash, we see, okay, it moves over here. And our equilibrium shifts from E0 to E1, obviously. But now, because as I already mentioned, below BP means we are in deficit, government will intervene. Why will government intervene? Because it is a fixed exchange regime. And now they will purchase domestic currency and sell foreign currency, bringing down the money supply, which will ultimately shift the LM curve back to LM. Like from LM dash, we move back to LM. Our E0 and E2, that is equilibriums, remain the same now. So this shows the monetary policy is pretty much ineffective in the first case. Now we will take the case of an expansionary fiscal policy. We notice an expansionary fiscal policy shifts the IS curves from IS to IS dash. You see that first change I have written, shown the arrow in red. And equilibrium shifts from E0 to E1. See, our E0 to E1. Now we see that the E1 is above, now we are above the BP line. And now it means we are having a BOP surplus. And again, the government will intervene because fixed exchange rate, but do exactly the opposite because now we are having a surplus. They will purchase foreign currency and sell domestic currency, bringing a change in the LM curve. Now our LM shifts from LM to LM dash. We see now equilibrium has moved from E1 to E2. So basically we see at the same interest rate, that output has increased. We have moved from E0 to E1 and ultimately to E2. So in this case, we can clearly observe that the fiscal policy is effective. So moving ahead to the flexible exchange rate regime under perfect capital mobility. Now it is flexible. So, you know, the economy operates with the help of demand and supply. There is no government intervention. We see again in this curve, we notice the case of expansionary monetary policy leads to the shifting of LM curve to LM dash. We notice this red line has shifted. Now equilibrium also shifts from E0 to E1, which is but obvious. Now we see our equilibrium, if you can see this one, it is below the BP curve. That is, there is a BOP deficit. which will now be, you know, treated differently now. So it leads to the depreciation of currency, which now will increase our net exports because they are pretty much cheaper, which ultimately will shift the IS from IS to IS dash. Now we see our IS has shifted, leading us to reach E2, our equilibrium, which is the latest equilibrium. Now we see at the same rate of interest, our output has increased. You see, from E0, we have reached E2. So in this case, monetary policy is pretty much effective. Second case, which is the case of expansionary fiscal policy, leads to the shift of IS from IS to IS dash. We notice that IS has shifted and equilibrium has moved from E0 to E1. Okay, I hope you can see that. Now there is a case of BOP surplus. Now whenever there is a BOP surplus, it will lead to appreciation of our domestic currency. Now since there is appreciation of domestic currency, our exports have become expensive, leading to a decrease in the net exports, which ultimately will shift the IS curve back from IS dash to IS and making us reach again the same equilibrium. So E0 is equal to E2. So under this case, we see the fiscal policy is ineffective. So guys, now I'll be explaining the imperfect capital mobility case, which is the Fleming's case. And as I had already mentioned, Mundell's case is more adaptable and acceptable. So if you have understood that, what I have taught you till now, then you are pretty much good to go. But just for your reference, I will explain this. I don't want to complicate and confuse you with the diagrams, which are highly complicated. Hence, I'm not going in the detail of this. But I'll be attaching a document, a link under in the comment sections below, where you can actually go and see the whole thing in pretty much detail. So coming to the fixed exchange rate case under imperfect capital mobility, we again see the expansionary monetary policy case is ineffective, whereas the expansionary fiscal case is effective. So lastly, concluding this with the case of flexible exchange rate under imperfect capital mobility, it is strange, guys, that both expansionary monetary policy and expansionary fiscal policy are effective under this case. Lastly, guys, to sum up this whole thing, I would say that under perfect capital mobility, we have noticed that monetary policy is effective only under flexible exchange rates and fiscal policy is effective only under fixed exchange rates. So this is all about it, guys. Thank you so much for watching this video. Do like my video and subscribe to my channel, and I hope to see you in the next video pretty soon.